Welcome back to Let's Play Pillars of Eternity. Blind. my voice is going bye-bye. I just want to see if there's a door into this place. I know sometimes the houses that aren't marked have doors. But that one doesn't. This one apparently does. Is that a door? It is, but we can't open it. And we've talked to that guy. He's looking for whatever's killing his pigs. Thinks it's an ogre. We've seen an ogre before, so... So anyway, we can't go in either of those, so we're gonna check out... I like how it's all lit up like this at night. That's pretty cool. I don't know why that just suddenly struck me. I mean, even if the bridges have lights on them. Looks like a really friendly, like, inviting place. I don't know if that's new by any stretch. Or, that's this way. The Dracogen Inn entrance. Or if it's always been like this, I don't know. I haven't played for several weeks. I spent time getting a backlog so I could get caught up with the other, my secondary slot. Now that I'm caught up with my secondary slot, I'm almost out of these episodes. Villager. Most who pass through nowadays are refugees or bandits. The roads are more dangerous than usual with that ogre about. Have Harond's soldiers been harassing you too? I could have sworn I heard the ogre just outside my window last night. He's got these guys all riled up about this. People who can afford to are fleeing to the cities where the legacy hasn't hit so hard. You'd think that having an ogre nearby would scare off some of the brigands. They're probably smarter than that to believe it. Yeah, it could be real, I don't know. It used to be a castle here. We tore it down during the revolution. Have you been to Defiance Bay? I heard there's no Hollowborn there. Let's see, more histories to read. Nanaoki Farrell.
I just want to find her. Surely even you can understand that.
Hmm. Reach out for the soul. That guy speaking can wait. Which I think is the lord of this village. You see this woman running through the streets of a small city. She pushes her way through the crowd, glancing over her shoulder as she does. Her clothing is torn and her hair disheveled. Even though she appears to be attempting to escape from someone, her eyes sparkle with joy. Her mouth is pulled back in an enormous grin, and occasionally a small giggle works its way out of her throat. While looking over her shoulder, she runs headlong into a well-dressed man standing at one of the market stalls. The moment she sees the man she's run into, her face changes. Gone is the glee, replaced by fear. Her grin twists into a frown, her bottom lip quivering. The man, seeing her appearance, expresses concern for her well-being, and she leans against him, weaving a tale of a brutish man with wandering hands. As she speaks, her own hands travel over his body, seeking and exploring. There is a shout from across the crowd, and they both look over to see a large, angry man approaching, roughly pushing his way through the crowd that separates them. She stiffens against him, feigning fear. The man tells her not to be afraid and steps in front of her to block the path of the figure who is coming nearer. The woman smiles, slowly backing away from them both, then lets out a gleeful cackle. Her protector turns, confused, and sees her departing, laughing and shaking a coin purse. She spins and races off through the crowded marketplace. Confused, the man feels at his belt. His face hardens and he yells, joining the chase after the laughing woman. Laughing woman! Losing herself in the crowd. Kind of not sure in reading this, the way she says her own hands travel over his body seeking and exploring. I'm not sure if he is aware of that or she was looking merely simply to, you know, pickpocket him, or if she was actually like caressing him and he was distracted by that. This guy just said that.
We're decent folk, my lord. Perhaps you should leave and check the wilds.
Lord Harond. Well, they're going over there. We're going to talk to them in a bit. I just want to see everyone else first. Sid is probably another person with the past. It's a shame that ogre took Rumbold's pigs, but what if it comes after us? That lord will have bigger problems if his guards keep pushing us around. Eorn. That's familiar. We're supposed to look for him, right? Harond's men already asked us about the girl. What more do they want? I don't go out after dark anymore on account of that ogre.
Good day, stranger.
Oh, good. Someone we can actually talk to. A redhead stands by the fire, tuning her lute and plucking at strings. She hums snatches of a melody as she goes. First time at the Dracogen? Normally I'd have a song ready, but I haven't quite worked out this tune yet. I'm writing some chants about the founding of this inn. Say, you interested in the story? I haven't finished the chants, but I could tell you about it all the same. Sure, let's have it. Oh, excellent, Kanna says. These rustic fables are always great fun. Let me get out something to write with. Pelagina rolls her golden eyes and exhales for an excessively long time through her nose. It was built in the time of Hadrit's Rebellion, and a Dyrian lady, Thanu, once had a keep here. One of the towers still stands, but the rest is said to be buried under the village. Anyway, she stuck to the side of the Empire, and a contingent of Duke Hadrick's Knights of the Crucible helped the farmers and colonists in the area turn her keep to rabble. Or rubble? The inn was the first building that sprung up from the ruin. Built with some of the same bricks the colonists had pulled from the Lady Thanu's castle, they say. Supposedly the quarterstaff of her chief wizard even got lost in the construction, mortared into a wall or nailed onto a floorboard. Anyway, the inn was supposed to be a haven and a meeting place while the locals built our new town. Yeah, what's a Lady Thanu? A Thane or Thanu is a man or woman who's part of the military elite, a knight, if you will. Typically, the position is inherited. A Lord Thane or Lady Thanu, okay, so it's the female version of Thane, owns land and also commands several unlanded Thanes. The woman who last held the keep here came from a long line of landed Thanes. What do you mean, supposed to be? Deerwood's an ornery lot, and the more these new neighbors met, the more they argued. They realized they didn't agree on much beside ousting the old lord. The biggest divide was over the Glamfellens and their nearby ruins. Hadrit's knights and their supporters wanted to keep the peace, but a group of misfits with more anarchic leanings that had formed in town wanted to go after the tribes the same way they'd gone after their lord. Soon, the villagers were fighting with each other as much as with the Adirans. In the end, memories of the Broken Stone War and the War of Black Trees were fresh enough that the Duke's soldiers won the day. Most of the other villagers came around, eventually, but some of the core troublemakers left to join the front lines of the War of Defiance, and others I've heard found their way into the Guided Compass, the most forward-looking of the Glamfellen tribes. I don't know if I believe that part myself, but it makes a good story. She points to the east wall. There's a portrait of one of the chief rabble-rousers and his rival in the peacekeeping faction. Someone's idea of a joke. I don't think they're particularly amused. I want to hear about the Broken Stone War. That was the first major conflict between the original Adirian settlers and the Glamfellens. Happened 3 years into colonization when some farmers knocked over an Adra menhir that was part of an Ingwithan ruin. The war didn't last long, but it spread quickly and claimed thousands. In the early weeks, most of the colonists didn't even realize there was a war going on until the Glamfellen raiders hit their villages. There had been small, spontaneous skirmishes between the colonists and the locals before then, but this was organized, and it was the start of decades of violence between the colonists and the Glamfellens. As you can see, Darewood's full of history, even in little villages like this. Tell me about the War of Black Trees. It started back in the colonial days, almost 30 years after the Broken Stone War. Even though isolated conflicts still broke out between the settlers and the Glamfellens, both sides had officially agreed to peace. Edring Hadrit, Admeth's mother, was Gref at the time. As part of peace negotiations, he had signed treaties prohibiting Adirin colonists from looting Ingwithin ruins. However, he'd been unable to outlaw the use of captured Glamfellens as slaves. What's a Gref? A Gref is the governor of a colony and is subservient to the Adirian Emperor. The early leaders of the Adir colony in the Deerwood, including Edrang and Admeth Hadrit, were Grefs. At the start of the War of Defiance, Admeth Hadrit declared himself Duke of an independent Deerwood rather than Gref of the Emperor's colony. It was the same term used for leaders of the newly independent Valian Republics. Anyway, we haven't had a Gref since.
I see.
Indeed. The taking of Glamfellen slaves had continued to be a source of conflict. It came to a head when Imperial agents, aided by certain earls in the Deerwood, began looting the ruins again. See, the Empire had never actually agreed to Hadrick's treaties on the matter, and the recent secession of the Valian Republics likely left them eager to weaken Hadrick's position. The looting sparked a brutal slave uprising and a guerrilla campaign among the Glamfellens. Edring Hadrit was too old to lead forces into battle, and so he sent his son, Admeth. Admeth made a costly but effective decision that ended the war faster than anyone could have imagined. He burned the forest near the Is-Ien River to keep the Glamfellen war bands from retreating. Thousands of Glamfellens died, and as Admeth repeated his scorched earth tactics in the following months, he wore down the remainder of their forces. To this day, over 150 years later, there are still sections of the Deerwood where the trees are nothing but bare, charred trunks. Farewell. This Eorn guy.
Why, it's you! Thank you, friend. You've given me another chance, and I mean to make the most of it. I've been telling everyone around here about how you helped me.
God, I don't remember him. I know the name.
Eorn.
I remember now.
I remember how it started.
He was in he was in the catacombs, the, Copper Lane Catacombs. We let him go instead of turning him over to the Crucible Knights or attacking him. That was nice of us. Nice of us. Dengler.
Welcome!
Innkeeper digs inside a mug with a dirty rag. His eyes under his thick brows are tired but watchful. He gives you a quick nod as you approach the bar. I don't know why I'm messing up words so much. Don't see many travelers these days. Something I can do for you? What was your exchange with that nobleman about? He looks up from polishing his tankard and glowers at the lord. Folk round here is decent. They mind their own business. You want to stick your nose in it? Go talk to him yourself. I have questions about Deerford. Deerford. He runs his rag around the rim of the monk. Ask. Have you seen an Orlan named Nefer? He jerks his head at the stairs. Twitchy lady, that one. Tell me about the village. Walk from one bridge to the next and you've seen it. We're quiet, hard-working folk. We keep to ourselves and don't take to being pushed around. He glares at the well-dressed man standing off to the side. Used to be a castle here, built by some family of Adirian thanes back when the Empire first came. Only one tower is still standing, and that's part of Tyrgal's shop now. Sid, that bard by the fire, could spin you the yard if you're so inclined. Oh, we've been there. Who lives in Deerford? Not many anymore. Hard to keep people around when everyone here is birthing Hollowborn. But we got a few who stick around and do business. Trigil's the leather courier. Hendina crafts potions, and Winfrith trades in general goods. Rambald's a pig farmer. Or was, anyway. Tell me about Trigil. This guy's got a lot of information. He's a courier. Treats leather and makes armor and a few other goods with it. Problem is, the smell of tallow and deer shit tends to put people off their food, and his shop's right next door. What's Hendina's story? Lady's a clever hand with potions and poultices. Got herself into trouble with a nest of worms, so I hear. Her cart's on the east end of town. And Winfrith? Been around even longer than I have. Nice enough fellow, but never could find his way to the end of a sentence. His shop's across the square. Something happened to Rumbold's pigs, I take it. Damn ogre carried them off. Now he squeals more than his herd ever did. He shrugs. It is rotten luck. Let's go back to my previous questions about Deerford. You said you don't see many travelers. Of course not. Why would they come here? We've got bandits on the road and an ogre in the forest, as that yapping fool Rumbold will tell you. Worse yet, hasn't been a healthy child born here in a year. Over a year. Most kith that come here is just passing through. About that ogre. You don't hardly see him this close to town. Ogres and kith don't mix well. Ugly bastards, but they're smart enough to know that much. You want to know more? Talk to Rumbold. His farm's southwest of here. I want to order food and drinks, see what he has. I'm pretty sure we've seen these dishes. And that's it. Got some stuff we can look at. This table has been scarred and stained from decades of use. The portrait depicts a man and a woman dressed in a deer garb that would have been in style a century ago. The heavy frame has been battered, and the plate that once bore the patron's name has been scratched out. They share a passionate embrace, which seems at odds with the disgust on their faces. That's interesting. Can we run back here and see what's back here? Pace. Heavy, sweet perfumes emanate from the barrels. The stave joints are stained dark brown and dull purple. We've got three beer. I'm not going to steal that. And pace. What are you doing in the kitchen? Dingle will get you sorted out with food and drink. Alright. This scolder head looks as old as the inn. Its leathery skin is cracked and bleached from years of exposure. Danda Valero? Another history. We've got that sound back now. That kind of went away for a while for some reason. Maybe the 2.0 patch fixed it? You see a man open the door of a house, slow with fatigue. He steps inside, unlacing his boots, rubbing his temples, wrinkle of a smile lighting his face as he moves into a generous kitchen. He calls for someone, slicing himself some bread. The house creaks gently in response. His lips purse, and he pads out of the kitchen into a large room with a staircase. Chewing slowly, he takes the stairs one at a time, calling once more. No response. His body freezes for a moment as he walks into a room upstairs. Nothing on the lone bed but an abundance of faded felt toys. Moving faster, he checks each room, his calls growing more urgent. No response. Any sign of exhaustion is gone, replaced with limber panic. He checks cupboards, baths, anywhere a child might hide. Nothing. Then a letter, next to the door he came in from, with a queer symbol on its wax seal, one he's seen before. He crumples, shoulders shaking against the hard wall. Nobody sees him weep. Or someone stole, like, kidnapped the kid. It's too bad that's not a quest we can undertake. But you can't interact with these people at all. These people with the histories. So I'll check up here and then I'll go talk to the Lord. I like to be thorough and all that stuff. This painting depicts a forested ravine somewhere in the Living Lands. This painting portrays the expanse of foothills below the mountains of White March.
Time to see and not be seen.
Who's coming up the stairs? It's not him. Don't worry. Nefer. The Orlin hovers by the window, peering out of it every few seconds. As you enter the room, she watches you carefully, her hand hovering over her stiletto. She cranes her head to peer behind you. Anyone follow you? Who sent you? Nefer. Oh, let's be nonchalant. I was just looking around. The man leaning against the wall glances out the door and nods to the Orlin. The hand over her weapon relaxes, but she's still watching you closely. Some old friends from Defiance Bay are looking for me. We're not exactly friends anymore, if you catch my drift. I'm just trying to lie low and mind my own business. Know what I mean? Boss. A hooded Omawa looks at the Orlin and jerks his head at you. All right, all right. She raises a hand to the Omawa before turning back to you. My friend here thinks you could maybe help us out. Now, I'm sure you're a busy woman, so I'll make it worth your time. She flips you a few coins. Just go take a look around town. Come back and let me know if the coast is clear, if you see any suspicious figures. She just gave us 125 copper. I don't remember this being in the dialogues, but that's nice. I like that. I hate going out of dialogue to finally see what she gave us, or whoever gave us something. Number 5's funny. I don't want to tip her hand so much just yet. You're pretty suspicious. What's this about? She scratches the back of her neck. I may have gotten myself into trouble with some powerful people in Defiance Bay. Powerful criminal people. I suppose it was bound to happen eventually. I'm a thief by trade, and it's hard to do my kind of business in the city without crossing them eventually. Now, I'm just trying to put some distance between us. Someone told me you were responsible for heinous killings in Defiance Bay. Let me guess. Was that someone named Medreth? She draws her stiletto. It's a lie, plain and simple. I got on the wrong side of his employers, and now he's after me. But if you're here to do his dirty work, I won't make it easier on you. Relax. I just want to hear your side of the story. What story? The Dominoes came after me. I just happened to rob the wrong place. How was I supposed to know they'd already claimed it? She runs her hands under her hood and through her hair. It was an honest mistake. I'm just trying to survive now. And if you spoke with Medreth, you know where he's waiting. Please, help me get out of here. I believe her, and we're not exactly on good terms with the Dominoes either, so I really don't care about them. It's true, he is waiting for her just west of the river, although I know that's truth anyway, because it doesn't have lie in front of it. Yeah, go east. Medreth's waiting for you just west of the river. How we would know he's still waiting there at this point, I have no idea. But hey, I'll go for it. She nods slowly. All right, I'm trusting you. Don't have much choice. See if you can send him the other way. That should buy me more time. She follows the hooded figures toward the stairs, giving you a final uncertain glance as she passes through the door. We just gained 324 experience. I love it how it's in the dialogue. I told Nefer where Medreth was waiting, and she gave him the slip. As a final favor, she asked me to send him off in another direction to buy her more time. Okay, we're not going to do that right now. We've left this room so we can look around. Admeth Hadrid, I have that. 27 silver fang. Okay. See what's in the other rooms here. Hello? Oh boy, more histories. We might not even get to speak to Lord Hadrit in this episode. You see a man, eyes tight on a couple, down a cobblestone road. He moves a little too obviously, a little too naturally, and his eyes never leave her mussed curls as he shadows them from building to building. The woman laughs drunkenly, hand entwined within another belonging to a sharp-nosed noble, flawless doublet, slightly too small for his generous frame. She brushes against him as they move, clearly far too intimate for her shadow's liking. His eyes narrow to angry slits as the couple slip into an opulent doorway and the nobleman's hand slips down her dress. Ooh. Her breath shortens into gasps as she leans into him further, moaning. Well, here we go. The spectator pauses, mouth pressed shut, veins bulging. He slides along the wall, dagger in hand, and just as the woman bites into the nobleman's doublet, he steps out. It's over in moments. He closes his eyes, dagger slipping from his blood-slicked hand, and bolts. Mmm. And Dayorn. You see a tall figure pacing the edges of a carpet, corner to corner, fingers twitching in irritation. The sound of battle grow ever closer, snaking its way through caves and corridors, past doors and soldiers, and the mage paces. Throwing his door open, he strides through the refurbished cave, taking scrolls from shelves and demanding potions from terrified grunts. Kicking a fallen chair from his path, he returns to his room, pacing, readying himself. As the enemy grows closer and closer, he begins casting, spell after spell, defenses, additional vigor, traps. Just as his skin hardens into metal, they stride in, swords flying and arrows buzzing. Last chance to rethink this, he says. An arrow whistles by his head in answer. He sighs, and his lips thin with effort as he begins his onslaught. There are six of them, but soon there are four, and three, and one. For the last, he takes a dagger to be sure, throwing it directly into the Orlin's temple. The man topples. None get back up. The mage barks into the hallway, receiving naught but silence in response. Frustrated, he begins to dispose of the bodies, the last person standing. The glass of this window is broken. Warped, knotted planks have been nailed over it. Just curiosity. The many faces. I'm pretty sure we have these books. And we're not gonna sneak. These guys are standing right here, so... This area appears to be empty, this room. Look at the way this shows up! That's pretty cool, it's a table. So if you have Mechanics 6, you don't need any lockpicks. Mechanics 5, you need a lockpick. Mechanics 4, you need 3.
I can do that.
Do you want to pick the lock? Yeah.
That's settled.
Okay, we've got a balloon. What? Is it automatically going to go... I don't have to hit shift. It automatically goes in. Okay. That's cool.
A simple test.
431 copper. Okay. Well, it looks like we'll have time to talk to the Lord after all. I looked at Danda, right? I looked at his history or something. Yeah. House Harond guard.
The guard keeps his eyes on the door. If you have information about Lady Aelys, you should speak with Lord Harond. Oh, Sagani finished escorting the supplicant and returns to the stronghold. Good. Nothing currently pending. Is there one we have? This one. Restoring the lab, finished in 4 hours. The Lord. The man wears Adair-style robes, simple but elegant. His fine leather shoes look like they were made for padding around indoors, yet they're caked with mud. He yanks at a lock of hair twined around his silk-gloved finger. His fine features are etched with anxiety.
My child is out there. Do they not understand?
My lord, we're doing everything we can. Unfortunately, these villagers...
Beasts take them all. I don't care how you do it, but find her!
He jerks a few strands from his head. I heard you arguing with the innkeeper.
A petty, small-minded man. Just like the rest of them around here. I've been paying him an honest fee for board and bed, and yet he can't be bothered to stir himself to concern for my Aelys.
Sure. Let's use our perception to, possibly cause trouble, why not? Actually, he seemed angry at you.
People from these backwater villages take offense for sport. You have to but show up with a full coin purse and they'll hear insult in the jingle of your step. They forget that Duke Hadrett came from the privileged classes, as did all of the other earls and lords who financed the rebellion they're so proud of. I've asked around, but nobody in this mudhole has any concerns beyond their swine. They turn my men away like beggars and seem downright pleased to be of no use. But you, you're not one of my soldiers. And you look like you're used to getting your hands dirty, if you don't mind my saying so.
No offense taken. His guard leans in. My lord, I... Harond raises a glove to silence the man. If you find her, he nibbles the thumb of one silk glove. Tell her I won't be upset with her. She can come back and all will be well. I just want to make sure my Aelys, my child, is safe. Nothing in the world is more important to me. I'd like to ask a few questions about your daughter.
Aelys. Of course.
He blinks at you and licks his lips. Describe Lady Aelys. She's a striking young woman. Bears more resemblance to her mother than to me. She has auburn hair and delicate, well-bred features. She must be, 28 or 29 now. Not for nothing, guys. He should know what age she is. Tell me about her disappearance. We'd stopped in Deerford for a few days. On our fourth evening here, I was making plans to continue our journey. Lady Aelys was feeling unwell and went to bed. When I retired a couple hours later, I found that she had vanished. None of my men had seen her go, and no one at the inn knew where she was. Since then, my people have been combing the village, but we've yet to find a clue, and the locals have been no help. Why did you and Aelys come to Deerford? It was merely a stop along the way to Aena's Rest. However, she took ill shortly before our arrival, so it seemed prudent to show her or allow her a few days to recover. What's in Aena's Rest? He frowns as if about to protest, but gives in with a sigh. Lady Aelys has reached an age where it is prudent for her to marry. Given this legacy business, I can't let her fertile years slip by, nor do I want her womb to fester in the presence of so many hollowborn. What do you think? These are intellect or survival? Although number three is a very fair question. Yeah, I'm kind of curious about number two. There are better roads along the coast. Wouldn't it have been easier to follow them to Aena's Rest? If I thought that, I wouldn't be slogging through the forest, would I? He waves a hand. The main roads are clogged with people fleeing one way or another to try to escape Widewind's legacy. It would be difficult for a caravan like mine to pass without incident. At the time, it seemed prudent to move quietly along the back roads. It seems there would be more potential suitors in New Hayamar or New Yarma. You think I haven't considered that? Arranging a suitable match is difficult. The best prospects for my child lay in Ina's rest. Where's the rest of your family? Surely they wouldn't want to miss your daughter's betrothal. Lord Harond is ill-suited for travel, I'm afraid. Lady Harond, sorry. And unfortunately, Aelys has few other close relatives. My sister and her husband, Elise's aunt and uncle, of course, have been visiting Adir these past months. He rubs his knuckles. And as for siblings, Aelys has none. My wife has only given birth to Hollowborn. Since Aelys, that is. I see. Going back to your daughter. Let's go back to my previous questions, actually. Something more? Go on, then. Tell me about yourself.
I'm Lord Nestor Harond of Defiance Bay. My family has been prominent there since Imperial times. Our primary estate is on the outskirts of Brackenbury, but we have holdings in New Hayamar as well. Those went to my sister and her husband.
Oh, goodbye. I may be able to learn something useful by asking around. He hasn't seen her in days. Okay, so I guess we're gonna ask around more. Do we just ask a random villager? The house around guard eyes you carefully. Glad we have someone else looking for Lady Aelys. The sooner we can find her and get her out of here, the better. Tell me about Lady Aelys. He shifts his weight. What's there to say? She's a lovely girl. Quiet. Keeps to herself. She'd make any father proud. You don't seem to know her that well. My primary duties are to Lord Harond. What do you think happened to her? He scratches his head. Could be a lot of things. The locals here don't seem to realize Hadrit's rebellion ended 150 years ago. Crowing about the castle they tore down and built their village over. I wouldn't put something like this past them. He shrugs. If I knew anything concrete, we'd have found her by now. You seem eager to leave Deerford. Why wouldn't I be? The whole village smells like wet leather and pig shit, and the locals have nothing but contempt for anyone who bathes more than once a year. He shakes his head. They won't lift a finger to find Lady Aelys, but it raises their hackles when we go looking for her. Thanks. Okay, we're gonna ask around a little bit more, I guess, and we might head outside the village to do one of these other quests. Thanks for watching, and enduring. Grow strong.